Time Warner Cable is pleased to be an underwriting sponsor for Carolina Week.
Coming up on the February 18th edition of Carolina Week.
UNC's next SVP will be Jasmine Jones.
We'll look at two benefits for kids who walk to school.
In sports, it's Carolina versus State Part 2, this time in the Dean Dome.
Weathercaster Corey Davis will tell us if we can expect snowflakes on our way to early classes tomorrow.
All that and doubling down to pay your tuition.
Carolina Week starts right now.
From the James F. Goodman Studio in the School of Journalism and Mass Communication at the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill, connecting campus and community, this is Carolina Week.
UNC Chapel Hill has a new student body president. I'm Elizabeth Edmonds.
And I'm Carly Swain. Jasmine Jones is the new leader of the 28,000 Carolina students. Jones had a lot to overcome. Thomas Edwards led her by 20 percentage points after the main election, but then Jones got endorsements from all four of the candidates who lost out last week. And although those results won't be official for a few days, Ed Green tells us that was just enough to make the difference.
It all came down to this. And after a delay worthy of an American Idol announcement,
UNC's next SVP will be Jasmine Jones.
Jones increased her vote total from 21% to 51% to take the election. She was impressed with the strong turnout that secured the victory.
I had the opportunity to really reach out, and they really voted. It wasn't a halfway vote. It wasn't, a thing where I'll just vote for it. They really paid attention to everything we did.
Her big sister, Jaren, was also overcome with emotion after a long campaign.
The moment they announced the winner, the name, he said, is proud to present the new student body president, that is. And I just started screaming uncontrollably.
She knew after the weeks of campaigning what was most important for Jasmine.
But first, a couple of days of rest. Because mom and dad aren't here right now, that makes me mom and dad.
Former candidate Ashley Klein, who endorsed Jones for the runoff, was equally excited.
I was thrilled. I was absolutely thrilled. I think Jasmine is one of those people that has worked so hard for this. She came in an underdog and she fought and she pulled this out. And these students have voted for her, these 4,000 some students, they believe in her.
How could Jasmine's day get any better?
Because I actually just turned 21 on Friday. So I now have, and I lost my license, but I found it today. So we're going to figure out something to do.
In Chapel Hill, I'm Edward Green, Carolina Week.
And from what we hear, they did figure out something to do last night. Jasmine Jones joins us in the studio. Jasmine, congratulations. What has this past 16 hours been like?
It's been like a twilight zone. You cannot believe it. It still feels like a miracle, but I'm just so ecstatic, and a lot of students have just said thank you and congratulations today, so I feel good. I feel really great.
Great. Well, now the honeymoon is over, and it's time to get down to business. So the first question we're going to ask is, following the bomb threat on Sunday, do you think there should be changes to the Alert Carolina system?
Yes. It kind of worries me that it took so long for the text to get out, and I actually wasn't informed. I was in the union and was not removed. So obviously there's some issues with DPS, but hopefully they'll be able to address it and tell us what they're going to improve on, and I'll definitely follow up.
Sounds like a good plan. Now, we're also in some difficult economic times, and the legislature wants to increase our student body, but at the same time, we might be losing some faculty. So what is your position about that?
Well, we have to always watch the enrollment, and we're told by the state that we have to take in the new students, but we also have to take into account our academic experience, and I know the chancellor really puts that at heart, but it's the students who have to push what we can actually deal with and what we'll actually stand for. So hopefully, throughout the next year, we'll find out, we'll be able to challenge what the chancellor gives us as our options. Academics.
Sounds like a great plan. And there's a lot of academic issues for us to go ahead and tackle with this next coming year.
Yeah,
definitely. And one last question. You going to the game tonight?
Oh, I gave my Phase 2 ticket up to somebody who helped me in the campaign. Watching it on the TV, but that's okay.
Are you going to chance our weathercaster? Is that it's from state, so give him a little bit of trouble.
I will.
We'll do that at commercial.
Yeah. Great. Well, Jasmine, once again, congratulations. You're going to have an amazing year, and we're so excited for you.
Looking forward to it.
Thank you.
We hope
so
to chat
much.
With you frequently and come back and see us.
I definitely will. Thank you.
3 days after the UNC bomb threat, students are still asking questions about Carolina's alert system. Here's the disturbing 911 call that started it all.
We're all going to be dead before the police get here.
Okay, David.
Tell me where you're at. What's your address?
I'm gonna detonate the bombs. I'm at the pits.
At 8:45 p.m. on Sunday night, the evacuation of the pit and main libraries began. DPS arrived at around 9 p.m. with a bomb squad, bomb-sniffing canines, and plenty of firearms. But it wasn't until 11:45 p.m. that students received a text from the alert system, and some students said they never received a text. Safety and Security Chairman Andy Rickelman says officials are still working out all the kinks in the alert system.
I think we really dropped the ball a little bit, and I think that we could have gained a lot. And, you know, that was DPS's chance to put their own spin on what was going on by getting an early message out.
Rickelman will meet with the current SBP J.J. Rayner and DPS Chief Jeff McCracken on Friday to discuss possible changes to the system.
Soon we could have a new speedy way to get to Durham and Raleigh. Officials have approved a light rail system like the one in Charlotte instead of the prior idea for the heavy rail system that's already in place from Raleigh to Durham, and then the light rail system from Durham to Chapel Hill. The whole system will be a light rail. The new system will include newer, faster trains and a rail line right into Chapel Hill. But don't start planning any of your commutes just yet. The new system won't be operational until 2025. And sometimes a simpler mode of transportation is all you need. As part of Orange County's 10-year plan to end homelessness, a local volunteer group called Recycle Re has joined Performance Bike Shop to donate bicycles, helmets, locks, and bike lights to the Interfaith Council Men's Homeless Shelter in Chapel Hill. Many homeless men work third shift jobs, a time when buses aren't running. The bikes will help the men run errands and get to and from work.
Back in the 70s, half of all children walked to school. Today, it's only about 1 in 5, and the CDC says the number of overweight children has doubled. Carol Breland has more about efforts to encourage walking to school as one way to fight childhood obesity.
At Sewell Elementary School in Chapel Hill, parents have to drive their children to school or put them on a bus. If nearby neighborhoods had safe walking routes to school, then going by foot would be an option. Ephesus Elementary School, located in an older part of the city, is different. This aerial map shows how streets lined with sidewalks lead directly via a crosswalk to Ephesus School. Christine Jernigan walks her first grade daughter to the school every day.
It wakes you up to be outside in the morning as opposed to just jumping in the car. You've had some fresh air to get you going. And it gives me those last minute chances to talk to the kids.
One of the most important things you need in a walk to school program is a sidewalk. And as you see, this sidewalk goes all the way to Ephesus School. Sarah O'Brien works to help others across the state understand walking to school helps fight a bigger problem.
North Carolina does have an obesity problem as well as the rest of the nation. And so that's something that definitely gets discussed through Safe Routes to School programs is how to reduce childhood obesity.
Walking to and from school does more than just help children and parents shed pounds.
I feel a part of things as opposed to just dropping her off and going to work. And we meet each other and we realize we really do know each other from walking every morning.
Good for parents, good for children, good for the community. In Chapel Hill, Carol Breland, Carolina Week.
And the good news doesn't end there. Research shows that active children grow into active adults. And there's some also other good news. Anoop, there it is. Anoop, there he is.
I was going to say, we just got a break.
But we'll tell you about Carolina's favorite singer when we come back.
Hello. Yes. Can I ask a few questions about the apartment on Park Street?
What was your name?
My name is Juan Hernandez.
It's been rented.
Oh, it's gone. Hello, my name is Sanjay Kumar. I am calling about the apartment on Park Street.
It's not available.
Not available?
Hello, my name is Tyrone Washington. I'm calling about the apartment on Park Street.
Just been rented.
Hello, I am Chen Ling.
My name is Khalid Bin Ali.
I'm Tuan Vo.
Hello, my name is Moshe Goldberg. I use a wheelchair.
It's gone.
Not available. All right. Thank you.
Yes, hello, my name is Graham Wellington. I'm calling about the apartment for rent on Park Street. Is that still available?
Yes, it is.
Oh, it is?
Yes.
Really?
Housing That's discrimination is illegal. If you think you've been a victim because of your race, color, national origin, sex, religion, disability, or family status, call us. Fair housing. It's not an option. It's the law.
Hey, kid, what's shaking? Besides me.
Dad, there's something wrong with the fridge.
What?
Ooh, a snack.
Got energy hogs in your house? Now you have the power to do something about them. Log on to energyhog.org. Because nobody likes an energy hog.
Hey, they got Charlie!
Yeah, who cares?
Carolina students are hoping one of their own continues to rock the house on American Idol. Students gathered at Players to watch UNC alum and former Clef hanger Anoop Desai, also known as Anoop Dog, perform live for the first time in LA. Desai sang Monica's Angel of Mine, and while the judges weren't impressed by the song choice, they still say Desai remains one of their favorites. Only three contestants in this group of 12 will go on to the next round. UNC Clef hanger Steve McQuaid says he got a chance to talk with Desai on Monday.
And he told me that they actually are way busier than you'd think that they are. You think that they just have a lot of downtime waiting around, and they've had rehearsals, and he has about an hour of downtime a day.
If you missed Desai's performance last night, there's a recap tonight along with the voting results.
To save money, more and more students are making their own lunches. Cooking your meals yourself is one way to cut food costs. In-season vegetables and fruit are often cheaper than processed food, but eating out doesn't have to be expensive. Two hot dogs and fries at Sutton's, only $3.25. A bacon egg biscuit at Yield Waffle Shop, just $2.35. A burrito at Cosmic Cantina, $3.09. And if you want to stay on campus, you can grab some food from Hunger Lunch Initiative. Every Wednesday, there's an all-you-can-eat rice and beans buffet for just $4. And every good value meal needs a quality beverage at a low price.
So, are you guys particularly affected by the economy when you go out drinking?
Well, why do you think we're here, dude? It's half off Tuesday.
Half off Tuesdays at PT's. Music to a college student's ears. Especially during the recession, students and bartenders agree that bars with good drink specials have a keg up on the competition.
If I get a place where there's not a drink special, I will spend too much money and I will have to make sacrifices later in the month.
Now I make a point to pregame before I go out because in the end it'll save me a lot more money.
Tuesdays are one of our busiest nights. It's half off, and you can really see the spikes on the night with the specials that people like.
But even with good drink specials, students seem to be starting their nights later just to save a little cash.
Sometimes money isn't a big factor. Even though it might be a bit pricey, statistics show that people prefer Starbucks coffee.
I go to Starbucks because I like the music they play there, and I like their frappuccinos and stuff.
Whether you like the music, atmosphere, or drinks, most people are sticking with Starbucks for their hot cup of joe. Starbucks has been brewing coffee for more than 20 years, and customers keep coming back for more, even at $3 or $4 a cup. And let me tell you, on this dreary day today, a cup of coffee or hot chocolate would have been fantastic.
I think you're right, Elizabeth. But you know what? It might have been a dreary day, but I think the Heels are going to liven it up for us a little bit tonight on the court. And even though we have our Wolfpack weather forecaster here, I think we can keep it business and just talk about some weather.
Go Heels.
That's right. I think it's going to be clear enough tonight for the Wolfpack to celebrate a victory in Raleigh after the rain's over.
Corey.
Wow, a lot of hostility here. Don't spend too long reflecting on today's rain. Coming up, I'll tell you when you can put that umbrella away. That's next in weather.
When it comes to babies, appearances can be deceiving. Look at this brainwave. Very active. And this one, not doing much. You make the difference by reading, singing, and talking from birth. Studies prove it. An early start. Now that's smart.
Check it out, man.
What is that?
It looks like someone's belly. Yeah, probably lost it walking on the beach.
Man, just leave it. Let's go.
You know, Clarence, you and I should hang out more often. You know, he wears these cheap suits, but they look good on him.
So she says, why lobster?
You never know when a colon polyp is going to show up.
Aunt Ethel, you've been ducking me since 99 at St. Mary's. You
get the polyp early and stop colon cancer before it starts.
Do I look fat in this?
Don't wait for symptoms. Get the test. Get the polyp.
They love me. They want me here, don't you?
Come on.
Get the cure.
These are my peeps.
Hey there, thanks for sticking with us on Carolina Week today. I'm forecaster Corey Davis, and if you've had to be outside today, I hope you brought an umbrella, because it's been a rainy Wednesday so far. We're going to break in the rain right now, but we're expecting more tonight. Fortunately, all of that should clear out, and it'll make way for a nice sunny Thursday. As we continue to move through the work week, we'll head towards a still sunny but slightly cooler weekend. I'll have your weekend forecast in just a minute, but first let's look at the national map. As you can see, most of the eastern half of the country right now has seen precipitation today. That's anything from snow up in upstate New York and the Great Lakes region down to rain in the southeast. And if you just squint hard enough, you can tell where the rain is circling right here in upper Michigan. That's where a low pressure system is centered, and it's draped down a cold front here in the southeast. That's what's brought us that rain today. Now, we don't have to worry about any snow from this system just when the next batch of rain will come in. And if we look at the southeast satellite, you see that we're in a break in the action right now. Here's the rain associated with the heavy rain that we saw earlier today, actually about half an inch over at the airport. But our next batch is back here over Tennessee. That's where a cold front is draped down across Tennessee and down into the deep south. Even some thunderstorms associated with this system, and it'll be pushing in tonight. And after that, besides the rain, the biggest change we'll notice with this cold front is that we'll start to see much cooler, drier air funneling in from the Midwest for tomorrow and the rest of our week. So what does the rain forecast mean for your game plans tonight? Well, if you're headed over to the Dean Dome around 7 o'clock, expect still scattered showers falling, temperatures around 51 degrees. And after the game, still a chance of rain and even thunderstorms with temperature around 50. But don't worry, I think the sky will still be cloud-free enough for the moon to shine through so the Wolfpack can howl for a victory. Well, let's look ahead at your weekend forecast if you're headed to the beaches. Around 57 in Wilmington on Saturday, rain moving through on Saturday afternoon into the overnight hours on Sunday morning. And if you're planning on being in the water, I have two words for you, wet suit. That's because it's going to be cold. Water temperatures around 60 degrees. In the mountains this weekend, it doesn't get any warmer. In Boone, 40 for the high, a chance of snow mixed with some rain on Saturday afternoon and Saturday evening. But it's a great weekend to get on the slopes, though, about 50 inches of snow at Sugar Mountain. So as the season winds down and we head towards spring, still good skiing weather for you. A little closer to home, here's your forecast for tonight. Again, we'll keep a slight chance of rain in the forecast, but mostly just cloudy skies overnight tonight. Temperatures won't drop very far from what they are now, only to about 48 degrees. But as we move through the day tomorrow, you'll see we won't warm up much. It'll be cool. Keep a jacket handy. 52 degrees with partly cloudy skies here across the triangle. And a little bit further into the future, here's your four-day forecast. You see those cool conditions tomorrow. Also, it'll be fairly breezy, so don't get blown off the sidewalk. Friday will be much sunnier than today was, definitely. And by the weekend, we'll continue to be partly cloudy. Those temperatures will be falling on Sunday, 41 degrees for the high on Sunday and overnight lows in the 20s. So, guys, I got my red shirt and my white tie on. I'm ready to celebrate tonight. I don't know about you.
Honey, we got to work on your fashion sense, but good job with the weather. Good job.
Thank you.
Thank you, Corey. NCCU student body president Kent William Jr. is urging his peers to clean up their appearance in class. Perhaps UNC students should heed his advice, too. Baggy jeans, sweatpants, and sweatshirts are staples in any student's life. So, what's the cure? UNC's General Alumni Association hosts etiquette dinners. These allow students to experience formal settings that are often part of job interviews. Linda Conklin, manager of Alumni Career Services, thinks students need to be reminded of the power of first impressions.
They haven't really thought about, what is this saying about me? Is this the image that I want to convey? Is this the way I want to represent myself?
The college sweatshirt is here to stay, and the jeans, and the sweatpants, but the key is to know when it's appropriate to wear them. But we know that one thing that is always appropriate around here is any type of Carolina apparel.
Exactly, and Jason Kahn is here with his pretty Carolina blue tie to give us a preview of tonight's big game. What's up, Jason?
Hey, Corey, I got something for you.
Oh.
About that. But guys, if we win tonight, it'll be the fifth time that we have
swept them in the regular season against the Wolfpack in 6 years. Wow. Coming up in sports, we'll give you a look ahead at that big game tonight when the Wolfpack come to the Heels house.
I am folding the pants. The pants are long. Do they go on my head? Do they? Do the pants go on my head? No. They go on.
Everyday moments can become teaching moments because learning starts long before school does. Give your child the start they need at bornlearning.org.
Hey, there are a lot of ways we can help our community. Spending our money in Orange County, whether it's filling up the car or shopping at local businesses, helps maintain our roads, improves our children's schools, and creates jobs. Spending your money locally helps us all in a big way. So remember, shop Orange first.
We believe in a world where all people have an equal opportunity for health and well-being.
Welcome to Carolina Week Sports. You made it to the perfect place. I'm Jason Kahn. The men's basketball team already beat NC State once, and the Wolfpack is coming to Chapel Hill for round two tonight. In the game at NC State earlier this year, fans on both sides were reminded how bitter this rivalry is. Since that meeting, both teams have fared well, with the Heels adding 4 more wins to a 9-game winning streak, while the Wolfpack is 3-4 with a win against a team that beat the Heels this year, Wake Forest. Point guard Ty Lawson is looking to continue the play that made him last week's ACC Player of the Week, while Tyler Hansborough is looking to return to form after suffering a possible concussion against Miami. Now, we got a guy in here that knows a little bit about tonight's game, Phil Mitchell. He joins us now in the studio for more about tonight's big game. Phil?
Jason, a win tonight would give Roy Williams a 12-1 record against NC State, and more importantly, would solidify the Heels' place at the top of the conference standings. A little rain and cold weather won't keep fans away from a big game. Tar Heel faithful started lining up at 3 this afternoon for Phase 1 tickets. These crazy fans will likely get a spot in the risers. From that vantage point, they'll have a great view of Tyler Zeller. He broke his wrist against Kentucky on November 18th, and tonight we expect to see him in his first action in 3 months. The Heels could definitely use him down the stretch. Game time is 8 p.m. and at the Dean Smith Center. Tar Heels are going for their 24th win of the season. A number one NCAA tournament seed could be on the line. Jason?
And as I quote Deion Thompson, you can't teach 7 feet, so it'll be a big addition for him. Thanks, Phil. Phil Mitchell joining us live in the studio. That typical Honda or Saturn you see on campus might have more under the hood than you think. Carolina Week Sports met up with a few NC State students who take speed seriously. Jane Carpenter has that story.
The world of motorsports got its start on a straight line strip. Welcome to The Rock, the home of drag racing in the Southeast. Amateur drivers from all over the country come to race their rides down this quarter mile strip.
I ran another 13.48.
Nice. That's my best time actually ever.
Students from North Carolina State University have taken this pretty dangerous and very expensive hobby to the next level.
If you want to modify your car and get just crazy times and really push the bar, you can spend a lot of money.
He's not kidding.
I've invested about $1,500 in parts.
I think I've only spent around $1,500 to $2,000.
About $2,500.
To the members of the Wolfpack Drag Strip Club, that's money well spent on 10 seconds of speed.
You can let your car do exactly what it wants to do. You can see how much power you have, how fast you can put it down, and how fast you can go.
Fast is fast.
When I drag strip, I mean, I've hit up to 150, 160.
And that kind of speed requires just as fine-tuned of a driver as it does a car.
The first 60 feet is definitely the most important part of your drag racing. It's where you have to focus the most and where you need to know what you need to do with the car.
I know if I've done well through my launch and if I've had good traction or not, and that's just really when my heart's just pounding.
All that really goes through my mind is pushing clutch, shift gear, let out clutch, pushing clutch, shift gear, let out clutch.
Go, 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 go.
When you start going faster, 100 or so miles an hour, it's just really exciting.
There's no medal or prize at the end of the track.
I come out here for pride of beating my friends in the drag race, having the fastest car.
They risk damage to their cars and to themselves, thousands of dollars, and countless hours testing and tuning. To them, the risks are well worth it. In Rockingham, I'm Jennifer Carpenter, Carolina Week.
And speaking of racing, guys, the women's swimming and diving team are in the ACC Championships right now, trying to get that number one spot in College Park, Maryland, so we wish them luck.
Definitely. And we'll be cheering from them in the Dean Dome and anywhere on campus.
Sounds good. Thank you, Jason.
Not a problem.
Well, listen to this. Tuition could be going up again.
So students are looking for any financial boost they can find.
I'll tell you why this poker tournament is the best financial aid deal at UNC.
Mother taught me.
She's averaging 18%. Balance the budget. Increasing clouds for...
UNC TV. Your remote stops here.
If you have a story idea, contact Carolina Week at 843-8292. You can also visit us online at carolinaweek.org. If you have questions about this program, write Carolina Week at Campus Box 3365, UNCCH, Chapel Hill, North Carolina, 27599.
If you're struggling to pay your student loans on time, we've got a story for you.
There might be a quick, free way to score $20,000 for a scholarship. Rob Perez has more.
The first ever MyCardiBlanchePoker.com Academic Poker League kicked off this Monday in Raleigh. This isn't your ordinary poker tournament in which players compete against each other for cash or for tangible sponsor-donated prizes. Instead, this prize is a $20,000 scholarship to UNC or whichever university the winner attends in the state of North Carolina. NC State graduate student Miguel Marquez describes why he's playing in the league and why people are missing out on a golden opportunity.
I know a couple guys out here, they're graduates, so they're trying to, if they win, they're like, well, I guess I'm going to go to grad school and I'll pay off some stuff.
North Carolina college students attend mandatory preliminary tournaments scattered throughout the state, just like this one. Your average place in the preliminary rounds determines the size of your chip stack going into the final tournament at the end of the semester. The tournaments change venues throughout the Triangle to accommodate all the universities. Tournament director Matt Backman says this is a tremendous opportunity for those having trouble paying for college.
You know, the big scholarship we're also giving away is a big benefit compared to just playing for fun, which we are playing for fun. There's just a nice big prize at the end.
He said he has like 80 or so students registered, but only, as you can see, a handful come out, and it just increases everybody else's odds.
And what would you do with the money?
I'll probably stay in the grad school. I'm not going to be a doctor or anything. I'm a mechanical engineering student, so I'll probably just stay on and go to grad school.
Maybe people will begin paying attention to this golden opportunity once one of these lucky players walks home with a $20,000 scholarship. In Raleigh, I'm Rob Perez, Carolina Week.
Well, that's one way to get a little extra money for college. There's also a lot of weird scholarships out there for left-handers or above 6 feet tall if you play the bagpipes, anything like that.
Yeah, I couldn't do the whole poker thing because I don't have a good poker face.
Yeah.
I let people know exactly what I'm doing.
But you know what we do have? We have a pretty good game face. Go ahead and enjoy the game tonight, everyone.
That does it for this edition of Carolina Week.
Thank you so much for watching. Good night.